Hey, you guys, thank you. Not exactly the best weather out there to come here. You know what happened? My train, this is just a quick anecdote. My train, I was on Amtrak on the way here, and there's no trains going right now. I don't know if you know this. But I was stuck on the train, and then I was like, oh my God, I'm gonna miss my book talk. And I talked to two people next to me, and we ran out, and we got an Uber. I live in Philadelphia. And I looked on the Google Maps thing, and it said, estimated arrival, 7 p.m. And I got here. Holy shit. All right. I have to get that off my chest. It's an honor to be here in this very comfy seat next to Christian, sitting with you at this phenomenal place, the Strand. I want to thank Melville House Publishing, my editor, Ryan, and my editor, Mark. Where are you guys? You're here somewhere. That's my crew. Dennis and Valerie, Kate, and Chad and the crew at Melville House Publishing. Phenomenal group. Small publishers, they're going to heaven, that's for sure. And bookstores, too. and I want to thank my team at Creative Time, who have been phenomenal support and friends and just people give me a lot of guidance. This book, I'm going to do a little talk, and then me and Christian will dig into it, and then I'd like to hear from you guys, too. I wrote this book in the haze of depression from Occupy. Not that Occupy was depressing. I found it very invigorating. But this is written after that. And at that time, in 2011, me and some folks at Creative Time put together a show called Living as Form. And it was looking at socially engaged art or politically engaged art from around the world, particularly with artists blurring the space between art and life. And while working on that show, I was very aware of a different show that I wasn't doing. And the show that I was doing was people trying to make the world a better place. But I knew there was another show of people just trying to get their own in the world using culture. And it's a bigger show. It's the one I've grown up with. And I thought of it as the B-side, in a sense, of this exhibition. This exhibition was about artists and activists using culture to kind of get things done in the world. But of course, some would say, well, aren't you aware, of course, that the Tea Party uses the same things? Or aren't you aware that, in fact, marketers like Red Bull are basically doing socially engaged art in the city all the time? And my answer to all of that is, yeah, I am quite aware of that. And it's actually very interesting. And maybe that's something we should dig into. And that's kind of this book, in a sense. But we can get more into that. But I was really interested in a few things. One was, I want, on an art level, and this isn't just for art, this book, but I want to put art into conversation with larger cultural phenomena. Because certainly the art world, in many respects, still likes to talk about itself as though we are still in 1922 or something, that like modernism is just taking off, and our language of the arts is still, in the sense, removed from the other world. But I would say most of the lessons of the avant-garde at this point have been radically incorporated into marketing, into public relations, into branding strategies, into the way cities are shaped. And just to say, the production of how we feel is a very powerful force in the way power expresses itself, which we know. But what was interesting as I started working on this book is the difference often between art and these larger cultural forces is scale, profound shifts in scale, mega shifts in scale, kind of money that we don't talk about the arts, unless of course you're like a rich artist and then you are sort of talking like that. But in general, the one-off, the idea of the one individual painting or the one expression, this kind of way that artists think of themselves, that kind of discrete act, is not the way power expresses itself often. They think of it in terms of multiple images, encounters, impressions, optics. So one of the tasks in this book was to put art into language with that, right? So how do we talk about the one impression versus the image that makes thousands of impressions? That was one of the tasks. I also, as I started working on this, thought about this book, Christian and I are going to, he's going to say it, but we're going to avoid the T word for a while.
Till the end.
him, you know, small hands, because he's just such a black hole of conversation that we're just going to try to avoid it for just a bit. Just bear with me. But certainly, one of the things that struck me as I worked on this was historically there's been a long tradition of Marxist thinkers being blown away by how irrational the lumpen proletariat are, right? So like Marx writes this chapter called the 18th Brumaire, where he's like trying to understand why in the height of economic depression, the masses vote in, bring into power Bonaparte, and basically side with a tyrannical dictator as opposed to their own salvation. Sound familiar? And then Stuart Hall in the 80s in London, 70s, 80s, were trying to understand why did the working class, after all these labor strikes, go with Thatcher? Sound familiar? And then Thomas Frank, I know, it's fun, or we go to Gramsci too, but Thomas Frank, a great writer, wrote this book, What's the Matter with Kansas, basically trying to understand why the voters from his home state of Kansas sided with the GOP when the GOP had been decimating farmers with agribusiness, right? So the constant kind of lament has been like, why do people vote this way? Well, I do think of this book as standing on that, but at the shoulders of that basic concern. But rather, I think, than having an answer, I think this book is much more appreciating the problem. And the many of those writers I referenced often had a very Marxist ultimate answer, which was just to say, if the people actually understood their economic interests, they would behave differently, which is to just get back to a kind of classic Marxism, right? Like, if people just knew what was in their best interest, they would behave not like humans. But I feel like I don't want to posit that just yet. I want to really appreciate just how difficult it is for us to appreciate that we live in a society where the production of cultural programming or people producing things to make us feel a certain way is at such an extraordinarily unprecedented historical level, like just a constant psychological bombardment, that we really need to appreciate, since so many people are spending money trying to get us to feel certain ways, how important our feelings and desires and fears and needs to belong and all our intimate personal things are to informing why we do what we do, rather than reverse, which is saying that's not who we really are, rather than trying to say the Enlightenment is our claim. So I get into that and we'll talk about that. And I have a lot of fun in the book because I get to talk about the military. I have some fun talking about Starbucks and Apple stores and IKEA, all places that we all lament and embarrassingly spend too much time in. They certainly work, don't they? Did you know IKEA was built with the Guggenheim Museum in mind? Do you know that? Fun fact. Fun fact. Yeah, you walk through there, Ingvar, one of the biggest tax avoiders of all time with his socialist branding, walked through the Guggenheim in the early 50s and said, this place is amazing. It feels like you're going somewhere, but you're not. And it's, you know, what's fun about that is if you walk through IKEA, you get a certain feeling just like that, where you're like, I feel like I'm on a journey of someone else's design. Because you are. You're in a sort of beautiful, amazing, middle-class Swedish design utopia. And it's very successful. Largest number one sold book in the world, or number one printed book in the world, is the IKEA catalog. More than the Bible, just to give you a sense of scale. Nice catalog. You guys know it's pretty hefty too. But I digress. But this book's full of digressions. We get into the U.S. military, in particular, what's referred to, wonderfully enough, as the cultural turn in the military during the Iraq War. Maybe we can all harken back to another disastrous period in American history where George Bush, after he'd already declared victory, brought in General Petraeus, who basically said, hey, we're going to turn this war around. We're going to use a method called hearts and minds. And they called it the cultural turn in the military. And hearts and minds could easily be considered like a branding or marketing campaign. But it's very controversial. And I get into that because, of course, they also decided to bring in anthropologists to serve as ground forces in both Iraq and in Afghanistan. And so there's that. And then also we get into, I'm just kind of giving some broad strokes here. We talk about the classic conversation that everyone in New York has five times a day and doesn't get tired of, and that's gentrification. It's kind of your, someone said to me, hey, oh my God, you're still talking about gentrification? They're like, still talking about it every day. But certainly, you know, one is suspicious of creativity when every TED Talk, every tech company, Google, every real estate developer, seems like everybody on the planet is embracing the power to be creative and really in loving creative cities, you know, really building on the P.T. Barnum of real estate, Richard Florida, who sold America on the mixed race, queer friendly, capitalist ebullient real estate boom that would be the creative class. He certainly, it should be noted, to be fair to him, he has recanted his ways. I don't know if you know that. You know. Richard Florida is basically like, I was wrong. After I made all this money on it, it's fine. It's fine. But certainly there was a kind of misreading of Jane Jacobs happened there that to some degree has sold America on not only the arts being something that people do, but the arts as a lifestyle that must be encouraged to encourage the brand of urban living. And certainly that conflation of the arts and economics and urbanism is certainly very prescient and pertinent to our times that we are in and also shape the world that we are in. I mean, certainly I work right near St. Mark's and that corner looks very different than it did 20 years ago. But culture has a lot to play with that. And a few other things I get into. Another chapter is called, I forget the name of it, but what is it called? It's called, oh, that's a nice name. Sounding the Trumpet, Charity and the Image of Doing Good. I was really interested in this thing called cause-related marketing, where corporations know that the brand of looking like you're doing good for the planet is very powerful. And so philanthropy and also actual good things in the world as an advertisement are extraordinarily huge right now. And in fact, I know that many of you are familiar with the month of October and its incredible color of pink that comes around. And that is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And you've noticed everybody wants to get in on it because the biggest market for all consumer goods is women. And so I just read that the Israeli military actually painted one of their fighter jets pink. Not a joke. So you can have the Israeli military Breast Cancer Awareness Month jet. There's also, during that month, I'm sure you're aware of the NFL all wears pink cleats, but of course they do that because the market they're most desperate to break into is the female market. So Breast Cancer Awareness Month is a profoundly important month for most corporations. I'm not trying to be judgmental and we get into it, but it is something to think about, particularly since I work at a nonprofit that thinks of itself as social justice and people like to pay for it to look like it's doing good. What do we do? Riddles. It's hard to be ethical in this life. And then finally, the final chapter, there's a few others, but the final chapter also goes into computers I get a little weird about Steve Jobs. I'm sure you've heard about him a lot. But you know what's profound about Steve Jobs? You ever thought about that name, the personal computer? It's an incredible name. Because it's more than just like your own computer. The computer is very personal. And you think about Steve Jobs back when everybody was naming their computers the like R749. He named his the Apple. And that's a profound shift because he understood something that was really important, which is computers are very personal things. They are so private and loving and sexual and hungry and angry. But they are very different than your TV. They're like an extension of you, like some David Cronenberg film. They're these like weird sex machines. And he understood very intuitively that this relationship that we have to the computer would be so personal and almost like a intimate megaphone into the world, that our intimate lives would become accentuated, exacerbated, and perpetuated by this thing called the computer. And you pair that with social networking, and you have such a radical revolution in terms of the ways that subjectivity is produced, particularly in the age where making us feel something or affecting us emotionally is such big business. And nothing could be a bigger portal into the intimate thing than the social computer that we have today. And in fact, I would just say, we all know it, but we don't understand it. We all know it because we see everybody on their phones all the time, bumping into each other, unable to walk down the street very well. But what is going on in our collective heads? We're just feeling, roughly. I mean, we can get into the elections, you see it like there, but it's much more than that. The shift from the TV to the computer, which I try to talk about, is really a beautiful thing to see through in the light of the fact that we are such fearful, wanting to be loved, social little creatures who are now very connected through these weird devices. It's so radical, I think it's almost beyond the printing press in terms of the way it will shape the world, and we're just feeling it now. So that's a kind of broad strokes reading of the book, and now I'm excited to get into chit-chat with Christian, and again, thanks for coming out.
Well, thanks for that, man. So I've got a little bit of a setup here and a quote from you before I sort of like hit the question. So like you mentioned before, we're going to try hard and stick to the real-time awareness of the Trump corollary to Godwin's law, the idea developed in the 1990s by Mike Godwin that proposes that as an online discussion grows longer, the comparison involving Nazis or Hitler approaches one. In this case, we'd like to limit discussion of America's new commander-in-chief, such as he is, to the last part of our discussion and the Q&A, if we can, which I fully realize is a big if. Nato's book, I personally found, has a lot to say about how we got to where we are today, but to fully appreciate the experimental questions and ideas it puts forward, one should pay particular attention to the epical phenomena that its author places front and center for us to anatomize, namely, that the underpinnings of what theorists like Frederick Jameson have alternately called postmodernism, which he then trashed by calling the logic of late capitalism, politicians have long called the Pax Americana, and cultural critics like late Mark Fisher called capitalist realism, increasingly depend on a global actor that is increasingly in short supply in our modern world. After the Enlightenment, that actor was referred to as the rational subject. During the 19th and 20th centuries, he was referred to as Homo economicus, an agent who is consistently rational and self-interested. More recently, psychologists, social scientists, statisticians, PR people like statisticians like Nate Silver might term him or her Homo statisticus. That is, human beings understood as intuitive statisticians who are both good at interpreting information and judging probabilities. But what Nato points up in his study of our culture is that rational human agency is at least partly a fallacy, especially so today. A quote from pages 3 and 4 of Nato's introduction. As a global strategy developed at every level, culture has become a profound and ubiquitous weapon. And yet we remain unappreciative of just how dramatic this shift in the techniques of power has become. In particular, we continue to read the world as though it still had one foot solidly planted in the realm of reason. It is in our global DNA to identify as rational subjects. But perhaps this Enlightenment-era thinking could use a heavy pause as we discover just how emotional, effective we truly are. One of my key hopes for this book is to echo something that Walter Lippmann voiced long ago, that democracy is a fallible project rhetorically dependent on a rational subject who, quite frankly, does not exist. Really, NATO? Doesn't exist? Let me see if I've got this right. This book is a cultural study or examination of why people don't act rationally, or is it a book about how culture is increasingly misused to manipulate people? Or is it both?
Well, it's kind of both. And to be quite fair to people, there's a lot of, we expect a lot of ourselves in America. We need to get our heads around global climate change. We're supposed to understand complex financial systems. We're supposed to understand the machinations of governance, how our cities work, etc. And Americans in particular feel very up to the challenge of having an answer for all things. But, you know, when you think about it, where do we get our information from? And this is not just media studies. But if we think even more broadly about what actually makes us who we are, not just knowledge like you read a book, but how you go to school or where you work, what you do with your weekends, what your personal lives are like. There's a lot of information coming at us, and it's not accidental. And I think that there's a secret history to America, which is not secret, people write about time, where people understood what really makes people do things. And they understood it was not, you know, like behavioral economics. They were like, it's not all rational decisions out there. People are doing things because they're feeling their way, feeling and associating their way through the world. And I, you know, for me, it was helpful to just as opposed to in activism, you have to believe that people make rational choices because that's what is the left tradition to appeal to that. For this book, I'm not saying that we can't make, I mean, we had the Women's March that was amazing. I'm not saying that there aren't good things that happen, but I do think it is helpful to just let go of that for a second, to appreciate just how dramatic the situation is.
To appreciate, is there a way to sort of consider mobilizing that? Irrationality, for example.
Well, you know, I mean, there is. I mean, there's total ways to mobilize it. I would say we know a few things about ourselves that activists use all the time. One is fear has no opposite. Fear is the most important emotion in the human mind. When people say, oh, he's such a manipulative person, he only uses fear. Any person in power would say, well, why wouldn't you use the biggest gun in your arsenal if you want to win? Saul Alinsky, the community organizer from Chicago, was certainly not against using fear. And quite frankly, I think the biggest benefit we have right now is that he who will not be named generates so much fear, there will be such a profound backlash. And fear and hate, you know, is rather than being like this liberal-minded thing where we're like, fear and hate are bad, I just want to be like, fear and hate seem to work really well. And it's like if you hit someone with fear, their knee goes up like this. Well, if you want to instrumentalize emotions, fear is a good one, you know, like for whatever ideological purpose. I mean, and I say that too because, you know, we get into this a bit, but like, I mean, it can be a very profound thing. You know, when most activist things happen, the videos that tend to circulate the most and get the most traction are the videos of cops beating the crap out of kids.
Or the opposite, when someone's getting smacked. Yeah, obviously, yeah, those are the ones that work. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like protest porn.
Right.
But like that seems to be the language of that we all trade in, right? And like, and even, you know, in Black Lives Matter, like a profoundly important historical movement gained so much social media traction from the most horrific videos of police violence against people.
So why doesn't that make it to the theorist's paper then? I mean, why isn't that sort of, why isn't that echoed, for example, in theory or in publication or in strategy for that matter? I mean, I guess it is with Black Lives Matter, but I'm sort of mystified as to why there isn't much of an approach towards the, I don't know, towards the irrational, except from the left.
Well, it's a tricky thing because I feel like, this isn't even in the book, but it's kind of fun to talk about. So Aleister Crowley, do you guys know Aleister Crowley? Okay, magician guy.
Right. The
London.
Ouija board clown.
Yeah. So he believed, he had these things, black magic and white magic. And black magic was basically using signs and symbols to make someone do something, right? Mythologies or culture. And white magic was to not instrumentalize these things too. Well, in a kind of crass way, I feel like many of us trade right now in black magic in a very basic level, whether it's, and to be more simple about it, I mean, to be kind of really classic, like your Facebook page, your online presence is a really good way to get at it. You're somewhere always caught between your image of yourself and your instrumentalizing of your own image of yourself. Does it make sense? That you understand basic rules of advertising and branding, and that the way we even have to construct our own identities is caught up within this language of being effective with culture.
Your second chapter is titled The Persuaders. Do you want to give us some idea of what those people do or have done?
Sure. So there's, I call a lot from an incredible book by Stuart Ewan called PR. And funny enough, we should also mention Adam Curtis, whose film Century of the Self certainly informed a big part of the beginning of this book. Are you guys familiar with Adam Curtis? And then he's got this other... In fact, we were joking earlier.
We were talking about that yesterday, hypernormalization.
Yeah, it seems like a few different roads I went down, I'd find Adam Curtis at the end of the cul-de-sac looking at me like, I was already here. Fine, Adam Curtis. But certainly, The Persuaders is a look at early public relations and advertising, and Edward Bernays, the double nephew of Sigmund Freud, features prominently in that beginning. He was a early public relations guy who, I don't give him as much credit as Adam Curtis does. I think he just had an intuitive sense, like Karl Rove did, of how culture gets people to do stuff. And he was a good PR man, like kind of like a P.T. Barnum. But then we also talk about Ivy Lee, who, funny enough, was William Burroughs's uncle. We're in a world of uncles and nephews. But it's interesting the connection between Burroughs and Ivy Lee. Because Ivy Lee, who represented the industry in against one of the biggest miner strikes early on, really understood what we all know, take for granted politics now, but was spin, how to really use spin in a profound way, and really kind of laid a lot of early groundwork in terms of that. So that's the first chapter, is to just kind of get into that early understanding of truthiness and showmanship as knowledge production.
And sets of alternate facts.
Exactly.
Yeah. You said the following to me in a recent conversation. A lot of social movements do themselves a disservice by thinking that economists are behind, economics are behind everything. What do you mean by that? Use mine.
Thanks.
Want to try this one out?
Yeah. Okay. Well, the problem with analyzing capitalism is because it's everywhere, you think you have the answer for everything. That's a kind of classic Marxist activist problem. Which is, you'll be like, well, of course that's happening. It's capitalism. But that's like if a fish critiqued the universe because there's water everywhere. It's not exactly an answer. And as much as I think economics do play into a lot, I actually simultaneously believe that Our intimate needs and our fears and us as subjects do not play along classic rational lines. And that being said, that's why most Marxist philosophers constantly can't get right the theory of revolution. I mean, Marx clearly got it wrong. He even admitted it, ultimately. I mean, at this point, the Marxist real answer is the only agent that's going to push back on capitalism is the earth itself through climate change. But I think that, you know, there's just not a profound respect for just how deeply intimate we are with activism, and that we don't have answers to all kinds of social phenomena. That's just from my gut with activism in general, is that, and also there's a real, it's not to say that I don't believe like basic activist things like healthcare and social justice in terms of, I mean, we can get into some basic policy things that would be very helpful to most people. But I typically, the language is not very appreciative of the radically complex cultural landscape we're in.
Well, what it doesn't seem, what you seem to be, what you're pointing out is that it doesn't seem to be appreciative of sort of the emotional turn, you know, or the irrational turn. And I think that's a really sort of super important part of your book, you know. And I'm also super interested that it frankly dovetails with hypernormalization and a couple other things out there, you know, with this new Michael Finley book about those two Israeli psychologists that basically invented behavioral economics. You know, it all is predicated on basically an irrational subject, which as people of the left, we should be sort of like running away from. And I see you running towards it, and that makes me interested.
You know, the only thing is the other part of this, though, just to say, since we both also work in the arts, it's kind of fun.
Yeah, I would have mentioned that. Yeah, where the art comes in somehow.
Well, you know, it's... there's a few things to this. One, I'm used to people being like, art is inherently good, and that drives me nuts. Because
right.
I think it's patently, clearly untrue.
I can think of a lot of bad art.
Yeah,
that's
but
not
also,
what you mean. That's not what you mean. I know.
But it's not even how I mean it. I just mean that, like... there's a lot of pressure for all of us to be very interesting, self-expressive people.
Mm-hmm.
And that innate value we hold up is like, particularly in American capitalism, like the most important thing there is. You know, it's like, even Coca-Cola will tell you, like, they got the ads and like people are like ripping up their papers in their cubicles, you know, and everyone's like, I'm free, I'm an individual.
Just do it.
Yeah, just do it. You know, just get out there, do it. But it's not just that. It's also that I think that there is a way that the arts can be brought in. I think the way to save the arts, to be silly, is to just to put it into conversation with the other forces that are out there. And it also means we have to re-language up on the way we talk about art. Because like you don't talk about scale when you talk about art. We don't talk about impressions. We don't talk about optics. We don't talk about affect.
You mean this in the biggest macro sense?
Yeah. But when I think about like advertising
scale.
Yeah, but I think like people don't talk about like the way people talk about advertising is not the way they talk about art.
Right.
And yet we are talking about cultural phenomena in place. And I feel like if we can start merging these languages, we will find the things in art that are worth keeping. You know, because I do think there's profound things. I mean, the thing that art has on its side is it's got it right. We are deeply emotional, sensitive people that want to help each other when we're not so scared we kill each other.
We're not braining each other. Yeah, we're trying to help each other.
Yeah.
But yeah, well, and the connections that you made in the book and that you mentioned in your intro, you know, the Guggenheim and our men at IKEA. I mean, you know, those are legion. I mean, those kinds of connections have existed for a very long time, and your book is full of them. I mean, I'm trying to remember where you get to Dada or what Dada props up. Help me there, but I don't remember specifically where that is in what chapter, but that is one of many moments that you lay out these sort of serendipities, which in fact are not serendipities. They're borrowings. They're actual connections.
What's amazing, because, you know, so when Walter Benjamin goes through the Paris arcades, and what's interesting about that is he's trying to imagine. I mean, it's so, what Walter Benjamin experienced, we all know so well, we don't even think it's remarkable. But what he experienced going through the Paris arcades was basically our first mall.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And he's like looking in these things and it's like
shopping envy.
Okay, cool. And he's like, oh my gosh, they're really trying to like get my attention. They got like angels over here. And then they've got these like references to like Greek mythology over there.
Marzipan over here.
Yeah, they're like marzipan over here. They're really trying to get my attention. But for him, what's amazing for me is like Benjamin, for him, that's a novel experience. But he's looking into the crystal ball of our worlds, right? Like right. IKEA is nowhere on the radar, where you're literally in a three-dimensional cheap hot dog and meatballs. Kids, like in the book, I talk about the incredible success and demise of the daycare that IKEA offered, because of course they uphold these socialist values, even though they're like the most destructively capitalist organization, but they, you know, they're blue and yellow and they actually have childcare. But apparently the one that's over there in Red Hook was so overrun with parents desperate for childcare that they had to rethink the whole thing because it was just like a kid's chaos zone. And they're like, we didn't really mean it. We're not actually a social democracy here. And everyone's like, please, I need a little bit of that socialism, IKEA. Eat some meatballs. But just to say, you know, like what's profound from the shift from the Paris arcades to IKEA is just the radical shift in how all consuming a brand can be.
Right.
Like that the brand is actually a lived service providing world.
Think about Amazon. I mean, it's coming into your own home. In fact, you don't even need to step out, get in the car and go to IKEA, go to Red Hook. It's just right there. You're living that virtually.
I mean, it's crazy too. You know what? I feel really awful. I mean, I use Amazon. I'm sorry, Strands.
No, we all do.
I know. And I just feel like such a dick. But you know, I was thinking about this too, because this book is not meant to.
Uber. You use Uber?
I took that Uber from Philly to here.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, that's right. That's how you got here.
Yeah, dude.
Thank you.
I became a shareholder on this trip.
before we run out of time, I do want to get to the T word. You know,
right? Yeah.
And I want to get to your fear chapter, which I remember. Let's see what you've called fear machines, right?
Yeah.
So, in the chapter on fear machines, you referred to an infrastructure of fear. That should be like a title of a movie, man. What is an infrastructure of fear?
Well, you know, the most classic example is prisons.
Right.
People, you know, that's why I hate the term the prison industrial complex. That gets into this economics thing. It's not accurate. The prison industrial complex would make you believe that the reason prisons are made is to make money. But the reason, in my opinion, prisons are made is because you can get a lot of power out of people being afraid of someone. And people being afraid of someone, whether it's those inner city ghettos that Trump's going to fix, or during the drug wars, which is when they went skyrocketing under, as Michelle Alexander points out, under Reagan and under Bush and mostly under Clinton, the fear of the inner city black male became a calling card for every politician to get cheap political points. And through that, over the course of a decade, built the biggest infrastructure of fear. Like, it has no rational reason for being there. It doesn't even make sense. No one's even interested in if it makes sense. It's just an aggregate of cheap uses of fear.
In an interview with a colleague of mine at Artnet, you said that hope is not the opposite of fear. What do you mean by that?
Well, you know, I don't, I just don't think fear has an opposite, like I said earlier. Like, I don't think if you went, hey, I'm going to give you something to hope for, you just go, huh. If someone says, holy shit, there was a man behind you with a knife, you run. And I just don't think we're programmed with this like beautiful dream of like good news versus bad news.
A Shepherd Fairey t-shirt just won't do it.
No. And also too, we can get into Obama, but like that was such a branded campaign. And to get into the Trump thing, what irritates me the most is, as much as I'm super anti-Trump, I feel like all the lessons that were learned under Obama about the complexities of neoliberalism, about the fact that there's fractures within the Democratic Party, about a class analysis, are getting swept rapidly under the rug for an abstract solidarity against this total demon, which is reasonable. But we are once again being mobilized out of antipathy, you know, and indignation has got to be the ultimate number one emotion of all Americans online. And we, you know, you point to the Trump people and you'll say, oh, they're trolls. Oh, they're such mean people. But we're all mean people right now. We're all sharing shit information. We're all memeing weird, dumb pictures of Trump. We're just like cranky little annoying people in America because that's just how we communicate.
I found this great quote, I'm sorry, from Curtis, man. When liberals tweet their outrage, it only benefits large tech corporations and only goes to like-minded people. I mean, you know, that's pretty true.
And Google's telling you
it involves all of us, right?
Yeah, when Google tells you do no evil. Google.
Exactly. Like they're not doing any evil. Anyway, I think we should probably take some questions.
Raise your hand. I can hand you a microphone and we'll all be able to hear. Thank you.
Hi. Thank you so much for your talk. Every couple of months I have this fantasy, which I know is probably a very first world fantasy of like moving and living off the grid. Because I think inevitably, as you've pointed out, we're all sort of participants in culture, whether you have a credit card, whether you have a Facebook account, you're a participant. And I haven't yet read your book, but I'm wondering whether you are interested in exploring at all examples or possible strategies for living outside of the branches of culture, whether that's a possibility at all to reject these branches of culture or in some way remove yourself because it is so all-consuming.
Well, I think it's a great idea for another book. I think it's a great idea because, you know, I certainly don't like analysis where it just says everything is the same. It's not. And certainly people have different relationships to the cultural machinations that are out there than others. I mean, quite frankly, if you did grow up in a commune with no computer or TV around you for 20 years, you'd be really different than other people, just simply put, you know. How you live informs how you are. And certainly I think some people are much more intentional about that than others. On a really just silly note, I was rereading the Unabomber Manifesto. You guys remember that? Mm-hmm. Very problematic guy, clearly. That said, it does read as strangely prescient in its deep desire to unplug and the deep Luddite sensibility that like that is a dramatic effort to get out of the networked world we are in. And as you know, there's certain accuracy in it in that regard. I mean, he also is like the biggest misogynist, like maniacally patriarchal guy and racist, but
no, it's perfect.
But I just mean to say I would not be surprised in the future if more Luddite movements did not emerge. And I think, you know, the tighter the web, the more dramatic people's desire to get out from it are. I mean, I take Amtrak back to Philly, and I used to love it because the internet was so bad that I could actually focus. Like, they would never advertise, we have bad internet. But it was a real sales thing to me. I was like, thank God, because otherwise I'd just be like my other life on here.
They should advertise travel to Cuba that way, frankly. That's not a bad idea. Anybody else? Other questions? I'm sure there are right over here. Mr. Sebastian Arasers.
Thanks. My question is culture in America left-wing? And if so, what do we do with, how do we interpret right-wing culture? I'm thinking of like Christian music or right-wing radio or all other forms of cultural production that apparently we don't consume on this coast or in our political circles. And is it pernicious? Is it, how are we supposed to interpret it? And is that a form of, is that a weapon, just like maybe left-wing culture is interpreted as a weapon in the real America, quote unquote?
Yeah, I mean, I don't differentiate them in this book, at least. And I don't try to, just to say with that particular, I tried, and somebody is going to be like, where do you stand with Raymond Williams' position on culture? And I try not to get really specific about that definition. So I am also guilty of a lot of conflation, because of course the culture you're talking about is kind of classic culture of like the ideas and symbols and forms of meanings that we belong to. And in that sense, in that version of culture, I would say that certainly there are different kinds of culture that bind who we, how we associate ourselves. And in fact, I would say if you look, I mean, you look at the red state, blue state thing, clearly geography and association play a profound role in the way you understand who you are, you know. Just to say, if you live 30 miles outside of a city, it appears, you are going to think radically different than someone in a city. That's just empirical facts. I think that says a profound amount about how powerful those forces are, you know, and should give us pause about our own self-congratulatory way of thinking about ourselves, since you just live in a city and think like everyone else in a city.
In your book, you talk about how corporations, political groups, etc., use culture as a weapon, and that they've taken it to this whole terrible realm. To what extent do you think the art world we all belong to right here maybe was the one that gave them the idea in the first place and has been peddling the same level of politics and bullshit and so on and so on? To what extent are we the ones who created that and we are part of it, or by we, all the different stratospheres of the eco of the arts?
I don't know. You know, we all probably have a gut sense of that. I certainly think that the arts were much more influential in the beginning period. I think branding and marketing and stuff like that took off, became a much bigger machine through the mid-20th century. And, you know, people like Ogilvy and Mathers and Young and Rubicam and these big advertising firms, I think once in a while they'll borrow from the art world, but a lot of times they're not. And, you know, it's so funny, like there's this guy, Leo Burnett, Burnett Agency, but he had, they're actually much more wily because they'll do things that artists would never do. For example, Leo Burnett had a yellow envelope of things he scribbled down, which was called corny language. And he was obsessed with like Midwestern kind of corniness, folksiness. And as him, you know, artists often are trying to be much more like outrageous and wild or stand out. Whereas for Burnett, his strategy was much more to blend in and disappear, to fade into the familiar. And that is something he came up with through advertising, not borrowing from the arts. And so I don't, you know, and I think the arts do a lot. I'm not trying to, economically, it's a different thing, because I also think we need to delve into what it means to be participating in the luxury economy. I mean, the arts actually, visual arts, contemporary art, benefits greatly the worse the class divide is, because there's more, because then you're in the kind of luxury economy. You know, it's a perverse relationship there.
Yes, sir. It's unfortunate, but true. More questions? I've got a quick question about sort of storytelling. You know, I mean, I think part of what you're on about, well, actually, there are two quotes here that are perfect. In your Persuaders chapter, you have George Creel, who's an investigative journalist, say that people don't live by bread alone, they live mostly by catchphrases, right? And then you have Walter Lippmann say that the public operates predominantly through what he calls pictures in their heads. So we come to the idea of storytelling, which is partly obviously what culture does, right? I'm trying to see the sag, you know, between storytelling and fear and irrationality. Because again, we're not talking about a rational subject, we're talking about somebody who basically sort of like listens to a good story and is convinced by it. What do you make of that? How do you reconcile that?
I don't know. You know, it's interesting. I mean, just
with your politics, with the situation, with this, again, back to Trump.
Well, that's the funny thing.
Reductio ad Trump.
Well, to go to the Trump thing or a lot of these things. I mean, we all benefit greater when there's a simple story to tell. Like, so Trump is a simple story to tell, right? It's why it's harder to rally people around global transnational capitalism.
Or climate change.
Who's the protagonist? Who's the who? What? But Trump, there's a protagonist, and Lord knows he's got many a story to fill in a book of all his wild tales. And I don't mean to say we should not move on that, but it is just that it's a natural way that we like to think. I was talking to Laura Poitras, the filmmaker who did Citizen Four, that on Edward Snowden, and I was asking her, you know, does it bother you as a filmmaker to make a film? Because films ultimately have to reduce all abstract political phenomena into storytelling. And she said, that's just how we have for so long gotten our information, is through stories. And it is so true. But there are limits to storytelling because we become very dependent on good guys and bad guys. We like to have a certain arc. We like to obey the rules of storytelling in our political analyses. It's, and I find myself victim to it constantly.
Hey, how's it going? My partner and I were at the Creative Time Conference in DC in October and walked away really jazzed from all the speakers and felt very purposeful, and then November happened. And so I'm curious about your opinions on, especially being people who are in the luxury class, who work in the luxury class, how has the responsibility of artists changed because of what happened in November?
Well, you know, the funny thing is, I actually think activism, if one only cared about activism, is going to do really great in the next 4 years. I think that Women's March was just the beginning of what might be the biggest social movement this country has seen that may even eclipse Vietnam, quite frankly. I think there are so many people galvanized, and for all the reasons that I kind of articulated why culture is problematic, I would say it's actually the same reasons why this movement will do very well. Thank goodness, I guess. I think many people are mobilized in this country because of Trump, because he's so awful. I think ultimately, too, quite frankly, on a very different level, we are having in this country, a soft Arab Spring, in so much as social networking has radically opened up the space of what is political discussion in a profound way. I mean, the fact, just to put your finger in the water, the fact that Bernie Sanders can say the word socialism without a problem, in the same way that Trump can basically be a Nazi racist without much of a problem, just shows you how wide open the space of political discourse is today. And I think that actually bodes very well for activist movements, for artists, for all kinds of incredible creative production. My only caveat is it doesn't necessarily untangle us from the complex machinations of culture that are out there. I think most of our social movements will be supported by Google and Red Bull. And every corporation right now that thinks of itself as kind of hipster branded is going to be right on your side. So untangling how all this fits together as a brand identity of social justice, I think there's some work to be done there.
Well, success, you know, in life or in politics has brings its own problems, right?
Sure, but I'm all for it. Let's just get the fucker out of there.
Right. No, obviously, you know, but you know, I think there's a breach that has to be jumped over, you know, from protesting clearly to sort of activism. And you know, as an art critic, my caveat, and I'm a big supporter of social practice, is to just, I don't want tons and tons of work that is nothing but social practice. That would be a very boring sort of like art environment.
Got time for one more question. Unless there are no more questions.
Could the excess of activist art dilute the purpose of activist art? Downstairs there's bags that say, I'm a feminist, et cetera, et cetera. Everyone's already selling products everywhere, t-shirts.
Yeah.
I'm sure there's a lot of artists right now wearing a lot of activist art. Could that be detrimental to...
Yes. I mean, America, you know, ultimately I would say America is a nation of hipsters in so much as we get bored of things that are popular very fast. And so I don't put activism and social justice in a different category than other phenomena. That said, it is a big movement and there are real issues. So I think it will grow, but I do think it's going to struggle with a certain kind of, I mean, all movements struggle with it, you know? Like Occupy Wall Street only lasted a few months, and already within the third month, it was getting like, there was a lot of internal tension about who owns the name Occupy. Different companies were starting to use it. And this movement's going to last much longer. So there's going to be a lot of grabbing onto it that's going to frustrate a lot of, don't you see? You imagine that, right? Yeah.
Well, thank you. And thank you, Nato, for the book. It's a fantastic book.
Thanks, Chris. Thank you, guys. And thanks for slogging out in the rain.